At this time, I'd like to turn our program over to our first speaker, which is Theresa M. Michele, Director of Office of Non-Prescription Drugs at the United States FDA. Theresa, welcome to the program. You have the floor and mic.
Thanks so much. So good morning, everyone, and I wanted to thank everyone at USP for inviting us to speak at this important stakeholder forum. You've already heard how important this issue is. So I'm going to kick it off by discussing how FDA has responded to the increased demand for alcohol-based hand sanitizers during the COVID-19 pandemic, some of the regulatory flexibilities that have been put into place, as well as evolving safety issues, which involve not just hand sanitizers, but go far beyond into the alcohol supply for all pharmaceuticals. So in essence, my role is to give some background on how the situation evolved, leading to the new USP testing requirements and the compelling public health reasons behind why this testing, as outlined both by USP and now by FDA in our new guidance that came out last week, why this is so important. So after I speak, Francis Godwin from FDA's Office of Manufacturing Quality will discuss the manufacturing and the compliance activities related to hand sanitizers. So you'll see some of the most important slides that I present a second time in that presentation from the compliance perspective, and that way you can get a better idea of how everything fits together. Next slide, please. This is the usual FDA disclaimer. So just to start off, if you can give me the next slide, there are a number of different categories of over-the-counter antiseptics, and these are sorted by indication and population of use. So for the purposes of this talk, I'm focusing primarily on consumer antiseptic hand rubs, which are popularly known as hand sanitizers. These are leave-on products that are not rinsed off with water. And then there's a bit of an overlap with these products used by healthcare personnel in the healthcare personnel hand rub category. And our temporary guidances on hand sanitizers actually apply to both indications. Next slide, please. So just for those of you who may not be as familiar with the regulatory processes behind how these live in our regulatory structure, there's actually two ways to bring a non-prescription drug to market in the United States. We have the drug application, NDA or ANDA process, and we also have the over-the-counter drug review process, which is known as the OTC drug monograph process. And these are quite different. So under the NDA process, which is also how prescription drugs are approved, the applicant submits a full application for the drug to FDA for approval. These drugs, once FDA approves them and they can be marketed, can be called FDA approved. Drugs that are under the monograph are not FDA approved. So the application under the NDA includes information about the safety and effectiveness of the drug. The drug can't be marketed until FDA approves the application. And that NDA is very specific for a particular drug product, including its formulation, its dose, its use, its labeling, and any changes to that product require a new application. So in contrast to the NDA process, an over-the-counter monograph drug can be marketed without FDA approval if the drug complies with the requirements in Section 505G of the Federal Food, Drug, and Cosmetic Act, which was added by the CARES Act, as well as applicable conditions of its therapeutic category-specific over-the-counter monograph. And we'll talk more about exactly what that means in just a moment. So except for any final formulation testing that's specified in the drug's relevant monograph, a manufacturer that's following that monograph does not need to provide safety and effectiveness data for each individual drug product. This is because over-the-counter monographs establish the conditions, including the active ingredients, under which an over-the-counter drug is considered generally recognized as safe and effective, or GRACE, and does not require FDA approval prior to marketing. So next slide, please. So what is an over-the-counter drug monograph? It's actually kind of a rule book. Think of it as a list of conditions for each therapeutic category that describes the active ingredients, the uses, which are the indications, the doses, the route of administration, the labeling, and the testing for an over-the-counter drug to be considered GRACE. Drugs that are GRACE and meet the other requirements in Section 505G of the FD&C Act can be marketed without a new drug application and FDA pre-market approval. Certain other drugs can also be marketed under Section 505G, and I'll get into that later in the presentation. So I want to specifically point out that an over-the-counter drug monograph, which lists FDA requirements for certain over-the-counter drugs, is different from a USP monograph, which is an official quality standard for drugs marketed in the United States. So the fact that both FDA and USP put out monographs governing over-the-counter drugs is sometimes a point of confusion since both have the same term, monograph. So the over-the-counter drug monographs put out by FDA and the USP monographs work together to help assure that over-the-counter drugs are safe and effective and meet appropriate quality standards. So for the remainder of the talk that I'm giving, if you hear the term monograph, I'll be discussing FDA over-the-counter drug monographs. And you'll hear more about the USP standards from other speakers later in the presentation. So the over-the-counter drug monograph system at FDA remains one of the largest and most complex regulatory programs that we've ever undertaken. There are more than 100,000 different over-the-counter drug products that are marketed in the U.S. under the monograph. And these over-the-counter monographs or rule books cover about 800 different active ingredients for over 1,400 different uses. Next slide. So as I'm sure you all know, the over-the-counter monograph system was changed and modernized this past March when the President signed the CARES Act into law. And with this monograph reform, hand sanitizers using certain active ingredients may be marketed under the over-the-counter monograph if they follow the conditions laid out in the 1994 antiseptics tentative final monograph, as further amended by the 2016 consumer antiseptic rubs proposed rule and the 2015 healthcare antiseptics proposed rule, and other applicable requirements such as CGMP. So the permitted over-the-counter monograph active ingredients for both consumer and healthcare hand rubs are alcohol, which is ethyl alcohol, isopropyl alcohol, and benzalkonium chloride. All other consumer or healthcare hand rub products containing any other active ingredients require an NDA. So let me say that again. All consumer or healthcare hand rub products containing any other active ingredients require an NDA. And this includes if you want to combine one of them with alcohol, isopropyl alcohol, and benzalkonium chloride, or if you want to try to mix together alcohol and isopropyl alcohol, or alcohol and benzalkonium chloride. If you want to do that, you have to come in with an application for FDA to review under the NDA system. Next slide. So all three of these current active ingredients all require additional data to determine whether they're generally recognized as safe and effective for use in hand rubs. Now, these three ingredients were deferred from the final consumer rubs rulemaking in 2019, while manufacturers are working to provide this data to support a grace determination for these ingredients. Also note that, as with all over-the-counter monograph products, it's the manufacturer's responsibility to ensure that their products have been properly tested, that they comply with all applicable regulations and statutes, and that the inactive ingredients used in the product are safe and suitable for their intended use. Next slide. So the other thing I wanted to note is that the monograph indication for hand sanitizers is a very general one to help reduce bacteria that can potentially cause disease. These products are indicated for use when soap and water are not available. And we get a lot of questions about the claims that are permitted on the label of hand sanitizers. Some examples of claims that are not permitted include any claims that suggest persistence or duration of effect, such as lasts up to 24 hours. Any pathogen-specific claims, particularly those saying that you prevent COVID, including any other antiviral claims and any superiority claims to any product or type of product. Next slide. So the consumer hand rub market, as you all know, has dramatically changed over the last year since the COVID-19 pandemic. Prior to the pandemic, the consumer hand sanitizer market was fairly small, with an annual dollar sales of around $190 million. In comparison, according to CHPA, non-prescription sales of sun care products in 2019 were $1.2 billion, and upper respiratory products were more than $9 billion. The hand sanitizer market was mostly made up of small businesses, and an overwhelming percentage of products used alcohol as the active ingredient. So since the public health emergency, these products have been flying off the shelves and use has dramatically increased. Unfortunately, unlike with prescription drugs, it's been very difficult to quantify the degree of market shortage. But it has been very clear that supply has not been keeping up with demand. There was an interesting article in the Wall Street Journal last week in which Gojo noted that their sales in 2020 were up 600%. So that's not just a small bump, that's a crazy increase. Next slide. So in order to address the demand for hand sanitizer, FDA issued three guidance documents outlining temporary policies to provide flexibility to help meet demand during this public health emergency. So when the public health emergency is over, FDA intends to discontinue these enforcement discretion policies and withdraw the guidances. We're continually assessing the needs and circumstances related to the temporary policy and have been updating, modifying, and can also withdraw the policy as appropriate. For example, in response to new data and questions from manufacturers, we've updated these temporary guidances four times so far, most recently on August 7th, to address a serious safety concern and also to provide added flexibilities regarding denaturant at the request of industry. Next slide. So this slide lists the three guidances I just spoke about. And under these guidances, entities that were not currently registered drug manufacturers can register and make alcohol-based hand sanitizers. Pharmacies and registered outsourcing facilities can compound certain alcohol-based hand sanitizers. And alcohol production firms can produce alcohol for making hand sanitizers, provided they follow the conditions outlined. As I mentioned before, these guidances apply both to consumer and healthcare antiseptic rub products. They do not apply to any other type of over-the-counter antiseptic product, including wipes, including hand washes. Next slide. So as outlined in the manufacturing guidance, FDA does not intend to take action against firms that prepare alcohol-based hand sanitizers provided all of the conditions specified in the guidance are met. So in very broad brushstrokes, this slide lists some of those conditions. If you're considering manufacturing under the terms of the guidance, or you are manufacturing under the terms of the guidance, I strongly urge you to read the guidance very carefully before you begin and periodically to keep up with any updates that may be made. The guidance gives a lot of details about these conditions, all of which must be followed in order for discretion to apply. So one important thing to note here is that only the specific formulas listed using only the specified ingredients may be manufactured under the guidance. So if a manufacturer wants to use any other formula or any other active ingredient, the product must conform to the terms of the over-the-counter drug monograph or have an approved new drug application. Testing is required to ensure that the active ingredient does not contain methanol and is of the correct potency. And that's kind of what this whole conference is about today. Different concentrations of active ingredients in the finished product, other than those specified in the guidance, are not permitted. Alcohol used in products manufactured under the guidance must also contain denaturants, which are specified in the guidance in order to deter accidental ingestion by children. And this is also consistent with the requirements for hand sanitizers under the monograph. So also of note, the formula provided in the guidance is an aqueous solution, and gel or foam formulations are not permitted under the guidance since they would require deviation from the guidance formula. Aerosol spray formulations are also not permitted for safety reasons due to potential issues with flammability and inhalation. Next slide. So this slide shows the formulas that are permitted under the guidance, and these formulas conform to the World Health Organization recommendations as outlined in their guide for local production. So we chose these formulas because they're very simple, they're easy to manufacture, and the WHO guidance outlines a step-by-step how-to guide. The WHO formulas have also undergone some testing, so it basically makes up for some of the testing that we would have expected OTC monograph manufacturers to do. Glycerin is added to the formula as a humectant to reduce drying out of the skin, and hydrogen peroxide is added to prevent potential contamination with spore-forming organisms. Sounds crazy, but hand sanitizers and all kinds of bugs can live in the alcohol, even though it is a disinfectant. So again, I want to emphasize that under the terms of the guidance, these specific formulas have to be used, and no other active or inactive ingredients are permitted. Next slide. So we have continued to work to update our temporary guidances on hand sanitizers to provide additional clarification on the manufacturing of certain alcohol-based hand sanitizers to both increase supply and help ensure that harmful levels of impurities and things that shouldn't be in there are not present in hand sanitizer. So since we've published our hand sanitizer guidances in mid-March, thousands of new firms have registered to manufacture alcohol-based hand sanitizers and hand sanitizer active ingredients, alcohol and isopropyl alcohol, which is great. So with increased supply available from these producers, we've heard that many hospital systems are now able to source an adequate supply of hand sanitizer, and consumers can find more of these products available on the shelves. I just wanted to give a shout out to manufacturers, compounders, state boards of pharmacy, and others who have worked so hard to increase the supply of alcohol-based hand sanitizers available to healthcare workers and consumers. and we'll continue to work with all of you and all of them to make sure that this supply is available. Next slide. So unfortunately, the flip side of this is that with dramatically increased use of hand sanitizers, we've seen a flood of new products on the market and a resultant reduced supply of USP-grade alcohol and isopropyl alcohol. And we've seen a variety of new and increasing safety issues with hand sanitizers. So one of the very first things we saw early in the pandemic was a really rapid uptick in the calls to poison control centers about accidental ingestion of hand sanitizers, particularly in young children. We had a 79% increase in the first month of the pandemic of these calls compared to the same time last year. And for those of you who don't know, children are much more vulnerable to the hypoglycemic, which means low blood sugar effects of alcohol toxicity, and they can get into trouble with a very much lower alcohol level than would affect an adult. So given that these products are, you know, like 80% alcohol, it takes only about 2.5 teaspoons, that's less than a tablespoonful, to be potentially lethal in an 18-month-old. And that doesn't mean that the alcohol was contaminated. That's just well-produced hand sanitizer. This is why we've been so insistent regarding the use of denaturants in alcohol used in these products, and are particularly concerned with products using packaging that can be attractive to children, such as food and drink containers. Now, more recently, we're seeing a large increase in contamination of these products with poisons and toxic chemicals, as well as subpotent products and mislabeled products, such as those that claim to be edible alcohol. Really bad idea. So we've put out a large number of communications about the risks of methanol contamination. We've published on our website a list of products consumers should not use, and you can see on this slide, there's a whole list of our actions regarding alcohol-based hand sanitizers. Last week, we published a guidance on testing for methanol in all pharmaceutical alcohol, not just hand sanitizers. And yesterday, as you heard, we put out a countrywide import alert for all alcohol-based hand sanitizers from Mexico. And you'll hear more about this in the next talk. We've also reached out to a variety of stakeholder groups to try to get the word out, including public health groups dealing with addiction and mental health services, to try to reach those vulnerable groups who may be drinking these products as an alcohol substitute. But it really comes down to you, the manufacturers, to make sure that these toxins are not in the alcohol and are not entering the drug supply in the first place. Otherwise, we're going to continue to see death, which is just tragic. Next slide. So methanol exposure can result in all sorts of bad things, including nausea, vomiting, headaches, blurred vision, permanent blindness, which sadly is pretty common, seizures, coma, permanent damage to the nervous system, and death. And although people using these products on their hands are at risk of methanol poisoning, the people we're most worried about are young children who accidentally ingest these products and adolescents and adults who intentionally drink these products as an alcohol substitute are the ones that are most at risk. So this slide gives just an illustrative example. There are others. But of the types of adverse events we're seeing reported. This case report comes from a CDC case series of 15 people in Arizona and New Mexico who were hospitalized after swallowing hand sanitizer containing methanol. Now, just of these 15 people, 4 people died, 3 were discharged with vision loss, including permanent blindness, 4 remained hospitalized, and only 4 out of the 15 were discharged with no complications. Now, as a doctor, that's just hard to wrap your head around and is just particularly awful, especially for an over-the-counter drug that's supposed to be helping people. It's also important to note that it does not take a lot of methanol to be toxic. It takes ingestion of only about 25 milliliters, which is less than 2 tablespoons of pure methanol to be potentially lethal to an adult. This is not to a kid, this is to a full-sized adult. Now, for children, the amount's even lower, taking just 3 milliliters, which is a little over half a teaspoon, to be potentially lethal to an 18-month-old child. Now, that's to be lethal. It takes even less to cause blindness. So, due to the risk of serious toxicity, including death, we're taking these issues regarding methanol and other contamination very, very seriously. So, unfortunately, as you'll hear, this problem doesn't just apply to hand sanitizers. Methanol's already starting to creep into other drug products. And given the number of other drugs that contain alcohol, some of which are oral liquids that are formulated for children, the consequences of this widespread substitution are the kind of things that keep me awake at night, and they're just horrifying to imagine. Next slide. So these are some FDA resources. If you have additional questions on hand sanitizers or other over-the-counter topics after this forum. And with that intro, I'm going to turn it over to Francis Godwin, who will cover methanol and other hand sanitizer issues from the manufacturing and compliance perspective. And I thank you very much for your time and attention.